This is a journey to the southeast side of Chicago, where steel is boss, where steel has dominated the lives of the people for 100 years. Neighborhoods now threatened with change and economic uncertainty. They say the United States has entered a post-industrial era. The neglected and, for the main part, archaic American steel industry is bleeding to death. And this neighborhood is bleeding with it. The churches in southeast Chicago seem to have been built in defiance of the massive structures of heavy industry. In these neighborhoods, you will find recent immigrants and the descendants of Eastern and Western Europeans, American blacks, Mexicans, and others, all bound together by the workplace and the uncompromising physical existence of high-temperature ovens and roaring furnaces. Ironically, this industrial community is little known by most Chicagoans. The road to Indiana, the Chicago Skyway, was built to bypass it. You travel high above this vast workplace without an awareness of the people below, far from the richness of history and tradition stored there. According to neighborhood lore, Chicago's Fort Dearborn was to have been built at the mouth of the Calumet River, but a young Army officer moved the site to the Chicago River so that he could be closer to a certain Potawatomi chief's daughter. From that time, a rivalry has existed between the southeast side and metropolitan Chicago, like its northern neighbor, Ainsworth, as this area was once called, was developed as a commercial, industrial, and maritime center. Since 1875, mill after mill located here, making the Calumet region, which includes parts of Indiana and Illinois, one of the largest steelmaking centers in the world. Wave after wave of immigrants poured in to work steel. As the industry developed, the workers built their neighborhoods. South Chicago, the East Side, South Deering and Haguish, four urban industrial neighborhoods, 100,000 souls representing every major ethnic and racial group to settle in America. Shipping, grain, heavy industry, rail lines and refineries, southeast Chicago became like a colony of some great nation. Its wealth exported, its people foreign and unseen. Of life in this industrial community, the people have preserved and reinforced the heritage their forefathers brought with them, their religions, ethnic traditions, and patterns of social relations.
greeting, Christian. Yeah. Come on, Angel. We're from Whiting, Indiana, Governor.
Hey, nice to see you. Hey, how are you?
Governor.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Can we have two pictures?
All right.
Two pictures.
Put that way.
One more. Did my wife have a picture with you, Governor? Okay. The Governor. All right.
How you doing?
Come on. Anybody take a picture? Go on.
All right, now I got the whole family.
Thank you, Mr. Governor.
Okay.
Two pictures, take one more.
When you visit Southeast Chicago, you can't help but feel the rootedness of this community. In spite of the harshness of mill work, the economic uncertainties, the isolation, there are people here who will not surrender the spirit, the energy, and the traditions that tie them to the community.
Today was the largest turnout of spectators that we've had in the 15 years. This is a great community. The committee that conducts this parade has again done an outstanding job. You, the residents, supported it, helped it, and made it go. So I'd like to congratulate all of you, the committee and the people in the community. And I'd like to also, although we're not supposed to have any plugs, thank our great Washington High School band. But applause is not what we're going to be after, because we're going to be after some dollars very, very soon in a large way from all of you to keep our great band going. And we'll be coming back at you for that and for the Labor Day parade. And it's an old cliche, but only a handful of people work and conduct and regulate this parade, and they do it on a year-round basis. They need some help. If you've got some ideas, get involved. And remember, together we can do everything. Thank you.
Check us out, brother Sheik. Top, best, everything you want, we got it right here. Step right up. We got what you need, we got what you want. Pants, $5. Tops, two for $5. We got Playboy Bunny, Sergio Valente, Jordan. We got it all right here. Two for $4. You heard that? Two for $4. We got Playboy.
First thing, it's a fascinating neighborhood. I knew a little bit about it from my folks, you know, my dad having grown up here and everything. But I wasn't prepared for anything that I found out once I got here. It's a rich neighborhood, and despite its appearance, it looks rather dingy and beaten up, but it's a fantastic neighborhood. I like to think of it as a sort of a microcosm of Chicago. You've got everything here in this small little quadrant, this little section of the city that you have in the entire city. You've got all your races, you've got all your ethnic groups, you've got your political power, you've got your labor power, you've got police, you've got everything that the city of Chicago is famous for, has a reputation for, is right here. Big labor, the steel unions until recently were, you know, they were the labor force in the country. They're right here in our backyard. They're two blocks away from the office. Political might that Chicago is famous for, Eddie Rodoliak now, is sitting over here. The people, the Poles made Chicago. This is one of the strongest Polish neighborhoods in the city. The Latins is the growing influence now. They're all over the place around here. The black influence in Chicago, which is now, I think, half the population, that's, everything's right here, and it's all in this little nutshell of South Chicago, the southeast side.
South Daring, well, it's one time was called Irondale. It was really the melting pot of many, many nationalities. And I myself, date back when I was born here in 1910, my parents came here in 1909 from Italy. And at that time, there were streetcars, and the streetcar would go as far as 106th in Torrance. And anybody who was Italian, they would refer him to a little shoemaker shop that was on 106th in Torrance. His name was Joseph DiOrio.
of course, if there were any other nationalities come in, they would refer them to the Croatians or the Serbians. They had a couple of butchers that were on Torrance Avenue that they would refer them to.
The ties of a community. We've all been in the same boat together. Whether you be white, whether you be Hispanic, whether you be black, whether you be Oriental, no matter what you are, we've all tasted at one time or another tough times. We've all known what it's been. Maybe I've known as a kid growing up, my folks being in business, I've known there's been times we've had to pinch our pennies and not hit everything we want. And that's the same thing probably that black people have went through, and Hispanic people went through, and the Oriental people, Haitian people, whatever people are in this community. And we don't have the super rich here. We don't have anybody who can snub their nose. Everybody in this community, the majority of the people in this community came up the same way. We've all worked for everything we've got.
On the east side, basically, you have a different type of people. In a way, they're clannish, but they're also very supportive of different things. Every time I turn around, I find that here we are in the middle of what is really a depression on the east side. And yet we are able to field 23 uniformed baseball teams at Calumet Park. And, you know, it's very difficult for parents to come up with $20-$25 to get their children in it, but they do.
Well, they lived in a little log cabin. The Indians were living there, and They had bad luck raising children. You know, they lost two children and they thought it was bad luck. So they were moving out of their log cabin. And my grandfather, he went looking for a place to live. And he come from the Dakota. And so he went across this little place. It was very livable. So he got talking to the Indians. And they said, well, he's welcome to it if he can make any use of it. So they did. My mother was about 3 years old when they moved in there.
Blacks were involved in the area very early in the century. And so before 1917, there were blacks in the area. And along with the Spanish population, I think all of them started migrating more heavily during and right after the First World War. The church has been, as in most black communities, the hub of community life for our particular group. The church has been that mainstay, that force that has always been the rallying point, or it has been the haven for the black community, and Pilgrim has been no exception.
Jim Fitch, I'm president of the South Chicago Savings Bank, which is in the middle of the steel community. I was born 3/4 of a mile from where we sit. The bank started out in 1902, and which measures up to be 81 years that the bank has been on or near this corner. It started down the street originally and then spent most of its early period of time on 92nd Street, just east of Commercial Avenue. And this building was started in 1926 and completed in 1928, and the bank moved in here just in time to be here for the Depression. You know, the people in South Chicago are the strength of it, mixed racially and ethnically and religiously and rich and poor, and it's just the broad spectrum of people and working people. Everybody lives in South Chicago works, or, you know, or today is trying to work, and probably a better idea, but it's a working people neighborhood. Nearly everyone realizes that when the steel business comes back, it won't be on the scale and in the proportions that it was here before.
My name is Joe Mulek. I'm the father.
My name is Dorothy Mulek, and I'm the mother of this group.
And this is our home and our family, of which we are very proud of. From 91st Street to South Deering, but that you would call it, Memorial Park of South Chicago. And I was born in Pennsylvania, and my folks came to South Chicago. Oh, about 1926, 27 or so, give or take. And Doris, where are you from?
I'm from Cicero. I was born in Chicago, but I lived in Cicero most of my life until I met my husband. And I met him at Midway Airport. There was a dance there, and he belonged to the National Guard. And I thought no one existed at this part of the country.
My wife and I felt that this was a good, quiet community. Maybe it wasn't the world's most exciting, and the people were most generally on the honest outlook. There was no falseness as sometimes you find in other areas. Besides the fact that I worked down the street didn't hurt the situation any, but it takes your choice. Either you live in the suburbs and drive 40 minutes each way, which you spend a good part of your life traveling, or you get someplace where you come home a few minutes after you leave work and you can come home and cut the grass or eat supper early and be like a human being. So that's basically, I was brought up in a neighborhood. I thought it was a good neighborhood. Maybe it wasn't the world's cleanest, but I still think that the people are down to earth. We're different than the rest of Chicago because we're better. That sounds, but really, you look at the metropolitan papers, they don't know anybody exists in the Southeast Side. And you go to children, went to school, and you're from where? Oh, I didn't know it. We're the best because it's honest. Maybe we're not the most fancy, but it's hardworking and honest, and I really don't think that our crime rate as such in this area is worse than, I think we're one of the best areas. Now, I'm not making a plug for anybody to move here. I'm just saying a fact. That's why I personally think that this is exception, that everybody works hard. And again, we're not the most glorious, but I think they're most honest. Oh, well, yeah, we have what we have is a prolonged vacation. From June the 25th, I've been laid off. That's June the 25th, 1982, and right now it's March of 83, and hopefully we'll be going back to work before the one-year anniversary. But I worked at Interlake, Riverdale, in the engineering department. There's been a lack of work because there's been a lack of orders for steel. Consequently, there's no construction going on, so I have nothing to do, and I'm on layoff. I've been fortunate enough that they still got me a list. I'm not terminated, although I can choose to be terminated, but things should pick up. I think that that's my current stand. It's very difficult. We're well off, I think. Well off the fact that our children are working and helping us make things go. I feel sorry for people that are laid off with little kids that don't have anybody helping them, because it's got to be purely insane to try to make up keep going.
That was a brother against brother thing. When they struck, as I said, on Wednesday of that week, I believe it was the 26th of May, the strike was supposed to be called at the midnight shift, and the Republic put rumors out that the strike started about 4 o'clock. So from a logistic sense, as far as the union was concerned, it got kind of messed up initially. The police then started to brutalize the strikers almost immediately. And on Friday of that week, which was the 28th of May, on the street of 130th there was a brick refactory down there that's been torn down in the last 10, 12 years or so. The strikers marched down that street and were met by the Chicago police and were brutalized and beat up. And that's what really triggered the mass rally of that Sunday. It was in support of the strikers. So the clarion call went out, and workers came from East Chicago, Indiana, and the west side of Chicago, and just to support the strikers. And Memorial Day, which was the following Sunday, they had a mass rally here by virtue of having confrontation with the police for two or three times during the course of the, you know, first 4 days. And about 2,000 workers and families assembled here and had a rally in support of the strike, the recognition strike, and then marched across what was then a field here. None of this parking lot existed at all, none of them office buildings, and marched to the then 117th Street gate and was confronted by about 200 Chicago policemen. Hell broke loose during the confrontation, and subsequently there was 10 guys killed and about 80 wounded by the Chicago police. That has become known as the Memorial Day Massacre. This particular plant here, the South Chicago plant of Republic Steel, wasn't the only plant where violence occurred in the country. Youngstown, Ohio, Cleveland, Ohio, any place the Republic existed, they resisted very adamantly and very vehemently. There were guys killed in Youngstown. This was the worst here, right here. There's a family here. Harry Harper comes to mind. He lost an eye on the prairie here. Going to try to coax his brother out of the mill. Harry's still living, I believe, somewhere around 76th and Winchester. He's about maybe 75, 80 years old now. Had his eye knocked out by a Chicago police, clubbed by the Chicago police, and his only crime was trying to get his brother to come out of the plant to strike.
Well, the main interest I'm concerned about is this layoff and the contracting out of jobs and things like that, and the threat of closing the plant down.
Well, the thing that we're going to do, we're going to lobby, and I'm going to work with the AFL-CIO, I'm going to work with our international union, and I'm going to try to get the management from the South Works to work with us in cooperation and putting pressure on our legislative representatives to do something, first of all, about foreign imports, unfair foreign imports. I don't want anybody to get me wrong. I feel we can compete with anybody fairly, but where there's unfair trade, where they're subsidized by their own countries and dumping their steel in here at low cost, doesn't give us a chance. What they're doing is getting rid of their unemployment to us.
So many of our people live in this community. We have a vital interest in making sure the community remains viable by doing whatever we can to keep the plant viable, because closing of Wisconsin Steel and the 3,000 people that we have laid off, you know, our whole community's in trouble.
Unfortunately, though, it looks like Southworks is going to be a smaller mill, but you still have Republic Steel in the area. That'll help keep some jobs in the area. But as far as Southworks, when I started in 1953, there was around 14,000 employees. A couple of years ago, there were 7,500, and right now we're down to about 1,000 people. Now, when they finally do stabilize it and the economy picks up, our mill may go between 1,500, 3,000, 4,000 people. I don't know how many. We're all guessing.
My parents came from Zacatecas, a little town Womacks. They came maybe in 1919. They came up on the railroad, and I guess my dad had worked on the railroad all the way up California, and eventually ended up in Chicago. He was very young, and I think he lied to get in the mill, Wisconsin. He lied about his age. My father got to be so well known. Any correspondence that came while we were living on Torrance, if it had Martinez, it had automatically come to our home. And during the Bracero period, where these men that were brought over to work in the fields, and they knew Pascuala lived at 10830 Torrance, and they'd leave the fields because they were earning such low pay. And I'd be going to high school in the morning, and I'd say, Ma, there's four men in the stairs. You know, don't worry about it. She says, just tell them to come in and I'll feed them. And she'd always have beans, potatoes, and eggs, and tortillas. She'd give them a meal. It was like the underground way. She'd give them a meal. They'd go on their way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They knew that they were welcome there.
Yeah. I recall waking up one Sunday and saying, you know, just once I'd like to wake up. We're
alone.
Just our family is here. And she took me aside and she said, I hope the day never comes when you need a friend.
Yeah.
If that's how you feel now. She says, all they need is a friend and a meal.
And later on, that one time, the immigration had picked up, I don't think they were illegals, but they had broken their contract. So when the immigration would catch up with them, you know, naturally they had to go back to Mexico because they broke the contract with the farmer.
Viva Mexico!
When you went into Bright School, how many kids were there?
Mexican kids?
Mexican. You remember?
It was Natalie.
Tulia?
No, the Dandas.
Because I seem to remember that I went to kindergarten by myself, you know, and there was nobody else.
It was a very small group.
Very small group.
Mm-hmm. And
it was primarily Irish, Croatian, Serbians.
And Italian.
A lot of Italians.
And
we all seemed to live in 107th, 108th.
The Mexican community committee is made up of a group of people from the community that are interested in providing programs for the youngsters, primarily in the field of prevention of juvenile delinquency. We also have educational programs, and we have programs for senior citizens. Now, all the members of the Mexican community committee are volunteer workers who give up their time after they get through with their own jobs to come and provide the services for the community.
It's been one of our traditions, really, from the beginning, is to at least provide some Christmas cheer for youngsters. In this community, as we know, South Chicago, in certain areas, there are pockets of poverty over here, or youngsters that cannot even afford a presence. So in a way, we do a number of things. We do soliciting from the local merchants and those that contribute to the Christmas party. Anything we make, we just spend right back for the children in the community, and that'd be the toys, the apples, and so forth. And the dance groups actually were part of the MTC's production under Rosa Marion.
Title 20 program.
That's Title 20. She's the one that instructs the children to dance.
Thank you.
My name is Officer Jack Jansen from the 4th District. I got a walking post on Commercial Avenue. For the last 3 years, we've started what is known as the Calumet Children's Christmas Fund, where we receive money from people for donations that are tax-free. What we do then is we take the children from the needy, from the schools, we bring them to Gold Blats here, and we outfit them with jackets, hats, gloves, boots, whatever they need for the wintertime. Well, it's quite obvious. A lot of these kids need clothes. A lot of them are fatherless, motherless. A lot of them were truant from school. A lot of them didn't want to go to school because they didn't have any winter jackets. They didn't have boots, so on and so forth. So we tried to help them all. And the last 3 years, it's the third year now, and so far we've done 50 kids, 52 kids so far this year. Last year we did 105.
Father, we ask you to bless this Christmas crib, that all who see the simple image of the child with his devoted mother and loving foster father may be inspired with awe and wonder and praise. Pożąda dziś każdy sprawiedliwy człowiek, ponieważ możliwa jest miłość. A miłość przynosi nam Zbawiciel Jezus Chrystus. Dios nacerá ciertamente. Cristo quiere ser para cada uno de nosotros esa felicidad interior que solamente Dios puede dar. So let us praise the infant Jesus with all his angels. Let us give him glory, and let us tell him how much we truly love him. The priests and the sisters here at St. Michael's extend to all of you warm greetings for a very merry, a very blessed, a very joyous Christmas.
Foregone conclusion that you went to work in the steel mill. Look out the back window and the steel mills were just, you know, surrounding the area.
I don't think I ever met a guy that went to work in the steel mill for more than 2 weeks. I mean, that's the first, and well, I'm only coming in here, you know, to get a couple of bucks and do something else. And 2 weeks then turns into 20 and 30 years. And I think you probably could talk to anyone in it. It was one of those two-week ventures or so. And there was a great degree of romanticism as well in the steel industry. And we've had instilled in us the school, for example, put in my mind, Hollywood, the movies, and sweat and muscle, and you know, a lot of that type of stuff. And that, and all of that was all right until you got in there.
This is Osashikaga retired steelworkers. We've been in existence now for 20 years. I carry no badge. I just want to inform you that we're going to have the mayor, Byrne, as our guest. We extend courtesy to any candidate running for office. Mm-hmm. We're not fussy who or what. We don't show any partiality to no side, no party.
No, I told these two women I'm going to come around.
Is that right?
Hi.
It's my pleasure to introduce
Robert Mayor Daniel Byrne. Thank you. I'm supposed to start my little spiel right on time, so but you can get on with your little spiel, I'm sure. Is that all right?
That's all right.
I really am very pleased to be out here with all of you today. And I feel very, very comfortable in this community. You know, my father was in the steel business for 29 years of his life, and he was with Inland Steel. I know I've met people here today from Republic Steel and from United States Steel, and Inland is right over there also.
I find that this neighborhood is very interesting because I'm a political reporter in Verdoliak. Alderman Edward R. Verdoliak, 10th. Is the chairman of the party, and he runs the whole area. It's his personal fiefdom, and politically, I think it's interesting right now because of the mayoral race. If Daley wins the race, we're sure to see some fireworks out here for a while.
For the longest time, the 10th Ward and 7th Ward, which are the two that are primarily down here, they were sort of like forgotten. They didn't get much down here. The mayor never came down here. They didn't get any new bridges. They didn't get any new field houses for the parks. They didn't get any new streets. They didn't get much of anything. Very few city jobs, that kind of thing. That all started changing when Verdoliak got into power back in 69. And there's been a slow but steady increase in the political awareness and the political power being exercised by this neighborhood. Almost directly, you know, because of Verdoliak. Here's a guy who started out life as the son of a saloon keeper, son of immigrant parents. He pulled himself up by the bootstraps, as the old cliche goes. And he did it. He did it all for himself.
It took me 5 years to get in Daley's office after I got elected in 68. And everyone in politics, regardless of what one says, goes through a period of time. Things just are not given out in equal shares and equal portions. In politics, in the home, in church, in business, you have to go and you have to fight for it. And sometimes when you've been around long enough and have been fighting long enough and get to be from a young Turk to an old bull, you can get more things done. There's no question I can get more things done now than I could 10 years ago. No question about it. So. It's not that I'm long in the tooth, but I learned easier ways, and I know I found out where more of the buttons were. And if you call that clout, that's the way it goes.
Now all of a sudden you see the South Chicago area, southeast side. We've got jobs down here. We've got political pressure. We've got new field houses going up left and right. You've got a strong business community that finally has a channel into the mayor's office. That's like Barbara Minster and Jim Fitch and all these guys from the business community. Now all of a sudden they've got this facade program on South Chicago Avenue, and they're getting rid of the vaulted sidewalks, and they're getting streets fixed up, and they're getting studies, and they get bus routes changed and things like that, which they couldn't get done 15 years ago. Now all of a sudden, hey, you know, you got Verdoliak, you know, he tells Mayor Byrne, listen to these guys, they're from my neighborhood, help them out. Byrne or whoever listens to the people that come down there, and all of a sudden, two or three weeks later, we got what we want. And that's the way it is in Chicago, you know, it's the city that works. Well, it works if you've got the power.
I hardly recognized Ed Verdoliak when I walked in tonight. He had his hands in his own pockets.
That leaves you nothing. Kissy, kissy. Go ahead.
That's great. Go ahead.
Spit all over Verdoliak. Why shouldn't he? Everybody else does. Look at his wife stone drunk on the floor there. Look at this. That's her with the open-toed galoshes. Hello. Hey, good comeback.
Well, it is a pleasure to be here. You know, I was reflecting just how far we've come. Can you imagine a black guy on the east side wearing a three-piece suit, eating rare meat, roasting your own?
Doctor, you'll find out soon. You're the only one in the room that's going to get a check.
When I was first asked to do this, I really was very reluctant. Mike Pavich said, would you do this roast? And I said, that's not proper during Lent. I said, you know, treating Eddie to a roast is like treating the guy that we crucified to a roast. And Mike Pavich stood back and said, you know, I never really thought of that. But, you know, I've seen Eddie walk on water, Wolf Lake. He said, I've seen people come from court, and Eddie says to him, okay, you can see now. Okay, you can walk now. Okay, you can hear now.
Now for some late hockey scores. Stand up, Ed. Let's see it. Stand up, Ed.
I'd like to thank all the people that are here this evening for this great cause. Eddie Burke in the tuxedo, like putting spats on a pig. Jimmy Fitch might be the sweetest banker you ever met in your whole life. I went to Jimmy when I needed money when I started in practice. He's the only place that has a nursery set up in the vault downstairs where you leave your kids for 4 years. I'd like to introduce now, or like to talk about another one of our guest speakers, and he was great, was Vic Lindbergh, who was a retired superintendent at the U.S. Steel, and he's a legend there. And like waste management, he worked for one of the major polluters in the area. See, Pete, let me tell you what happened. The check cleared yesterday, Pete. The check cleared yesterday. You understand what I'm telling you? You got the plaque. That's it.
Basic family concept, the basic community concept. And those words are nice. People throw them around a lot, but it works here. And we care about one another. We're trying to help one another. In times of crisis, in times of death, in times of fire, in times of disaster, one type or another, economic. This is the first neighborhood to run and throw a party and raise some dough for somebody and try to help somebody.
Yeah, I see you looking down with exploded sounds in the south side of the
South Chicago. The South Chicago Neighbor House is a community settlement house. And what we do here is basically provide programs for this community, such as senior citizens programs, programs for children between 4 to 13, adult education programs, and other kinds of community services. And basically, this is a fundraiser to try to raise money for our center. We're requiring $100,000 to repair the wall, the gym, and other major repairs such as a boiler. So far, we've raised about $45,000.
Citizens of the area out here, what we did, we combined together and devote ourselves to the program, as you see here, a safe, clean, updated community. That's all we're working for.
One-fourth of the Bush population depends on the economy of the Southworks here, and it is just terrible. We've got many people on compensation, public aid. There's been a great layoff in the last 2-3 years. It's been a tremendous, terrible effect on the community.
If you go to an average household in this area, whether they're working or not, most of the parents or the children themselves belong to 2 or 3 different organizations. They belong to the Fair Elm Civic League. They belong to their church group. They belong to a choir. They belong to a political organization. This brings everybody together, and this also helps one another. You know yourself that if you're feeling down, you need somebody to pat you on the back, give a little boost. You go in this area, in this community here, people want to help each other.
We're born of an idea by the mayor of the city of Chicago at a dinner just 2 years ago. She suggested to us that this would be an appropriate location for the creation of the international soccer field in the city of Chicago and a recreational play lot for the people of our community.
And I was very gratified when I met with the mayor approximately 3 weeks ago, and she said, "Ray, you can report back to the community of South Chicago that we have got the funding number for the new soccer field to the tune of $400,000. But just above and beyond all of that, I'm more appreciative to the fact that here in South Chicago, here in our Millgate community, we the people, the children, the adults, the leaders, always working together and always saying, no matter what project we undertake, it is never too big. It is never impossible to overcome. South Chicago is a very unique community. A very unique community because it's a community that will not die. It's a community that will continue to work hand in hand, neighbor with neighbor. And we will provide the leadership and we will show the way for the rest of the city of what things can be done when people work together. Next year, early next year, we will gather here again. And when we gather this time, you will see a beautiful, beautiful soccer field and a beautiful recreational field. And it will be lined by nice green trees and nice grass all around this particular facility. And that would be a tremendous change from what we have here.
Don't come here empty-handed. Yeah.
All right, 1, 2, 3, let's hit it.
Oh. There you go. All right. Oh.
The Spoke started back in 1970. It started back as a basis for to give the youth the outlets for recreation. What it is, they had an organization called the People Movement out here. It was part of the Black Panthers organization. And they wasn't showing positive things to the youth out here. So a bunch of concerned citizens got together, and I was a mailman out here during that time. And they asked me when I started working with the kids, we started working with the kids. We found out that there's a lot of positive things out here what these children can do. We got the youth here. We had to fight for the sidewalk right there, that vaulted sidewalk. We had to really put some pressure on the powers to be to get the sidewalks fixed out of these vaulted sidewalks. Within the minutes, we had 7 kids get hurt before we finally had to go to the papers and get a press conference before they finally fixed the sidewalk out here. But we have made up our mind right now, we're not going to be passive anymore. We're going to get to what's new is out here.
Just ride through this area and look how many churches you have. Look how well they're attended. And look how well they're taken care of by the people. The same people that don't have free money or leisure money still donate to the church, still believe in the church, still go to fish fries at the church, still go to church once or twice a week, participate in all of their functions. The church, whether it be what denomination, they go to church here, they believe in the church. Church is a savior. It's a place that gives them that lift again, too. I think that the church is probably one of the strongest ties that makes the family unit what it is here today.
It is my happy privilege today to join with you here, too,
to be with you, one in faith, one in spirit, and one in our great archdiocese. And now, if you will kneel, I will give you the Holy Father's blessing. Sit nomen Domine Benedictum. Adiutorium nostrum nomine Domine. Benedictio Dei Omnipotentis, Patris et de Filii et de Spiritus Sancti descendit super vos et mani et semper. And may I ask, too, an extra Hail Mary for my own problems in this critical day. God bless you.
Today we are celebrating Fashangi. Fashangi is the Slovak equivalent of Mardi Gras. We have the 3 days preceding Lent, and Lent, of course, was much more strictly observed. You see, in the old country, they couldn't even drink milk, have any milk products. They had very, what they called a black fast. They only had a crust of bread in the morning and a very light afternoon meal, and then maybe a little heavier meal, but most of the time without meat. Slovak Parish, founded about 1909 for the Slovak people. We're going to celebrate in 2 years our 75th anniversary. We're taking care of all these Slovak people who are on the south and east side of the city, but wherever there are Slovaks who are affiliated with this parish, it is our mission, it is our job to take care of these particular people. And it's not a very large parish, okay? But it serves this particular ethnic group.
And the other ethnic groups that were waiting for us, because we'd go to Hebrew school with cookies or a couple of pennies, because we were in public school till after 3, and then we had to be in Hebrew school at 4 to 7. So we had lunch or had something to nibble on, and they would look for snuff, and they take, and Willie would start Nate would start a holler, Willie, for his older brother, and they'd think his older brother was around the corner, so everybody would pay Willie to go to Hebrew school with him. We'd give him a cookie or a penny. You walk with me.
And bodyguard.
We went in gangs, because that was the little one, big ones would hold us and the little ones would hit us. And after I grew up, some of the boys that I fought the hardest with became my best friends, my best customers.
They were organized in 1888 by an affidavit. And they then got enough money from the various people who were mostly immigrants.
Lithuania.
A lot of Lithuania, Poland, Russia. They're all from East Europe. they were all very Jewish Orthodox, and they all gave money, contributed quite a bit of money, and they built this synagogue. This was the central place as far as Orthodox Jewry was concerned. And all would come here. We have a balcony upstairs. They call it mechitza.
The women.
The women sit upstairs, and the men all sat downstairs.
Evangelical Covenant Church at 100th and Avenue L. The church will be 100 years old next year. We're going to have our 100th anniversary. The services were in Swedish up until about the 30s, I guess, when they began to switch over from Swedish to English. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you.
welcome everybody to three great days of celebration for Heguish Centennial. And everybody always talks about what are we going to do with Heguish. If you would have told the people about 2 weeks ago that we're going to have the streets blocked off and have people standing in the middle, everybody together having a street sale at one time, they probably wouldn't believe it.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, may we present the lovely young ladies who will compete for the title of Miss Heguish Centennial 1983.
Number two. Number six, please.
All right, Gina!
Hi, I'm Gina. I'm 16 years old. I attend St. Francis de Sales High School, and I work part-time at Heguish Finer Foods. Thank you.
Thank you, number six. And the question for number two is, what living person do you admire most in the world, and why? Number two?
The person that I admire the most in this world is my father. He puts up with a lot of things from us. All of us kids, you know, I have two brothers, and he's had some hard times, and we've all had some hard times in this area. But he puts up with everything, and he puts up with all of us going through all our adolescent crisis and all that. And all I have to say is, if I could do anything, I'd like to be half the parent he is. Thank you.
The Heguish Centennial Queen is number one, Colleen Marie Mitchell. Colleen. Our queen.
I think it's great that they had this contest because it's something new for Heguish, and it kind of gets the whole community together out to do something, you know, and have their queen to be, you know, be proud of, say we've got a queen for Heguish.
What do you think, what are your duties going to be?
What
will your duties be as queen?
How about a picture of your old dad?
Sure, I'll interview him.
We're having a parade tomorrow. All the girls who are in the contest are going to be in the parade, and the queen will ride with her two runners on.
Heguish was its own little city in itself. We had everything, the baker, the candlestick maker, and everything else, and it's a good place to live. It had everything you wanted, all the facilities, you have a train station, you have buses, you have accessibility. You had a nice shopping area in Hammond. Eastside and South Chicago from Heguish is like another world almost at times. People didn't talk about going to South Chicago shopping. It was like the other side of the world. They go just as far to Hammond, but it just seemed closer. I don't know why. It was a borderline. I don't know if it was the river or what.
Thank you.
When you're going down, pig, you might as well stand up on there.
They want their dollars worth.
Roll up our soap.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. See your citizenry. Protest.
Get up.
This is great. How's the water?
Too bad.
What was wrong with it? Taxes are going up.
People who are leaving the Verdoliak Democratic headquarters on the fifth floor here are now being told that it appears, according to the figures that are being gathered upstairs, that Washington will be the winner.
This is a beautiful audience. An audience which I have been proud, whether you know it or not, to have worked for you for years. I'm not searching for favor. I'm not looking for hosannas. I don't really care whether people like me or not. I don't look for love. I look to do my job. And I'll do my job. And all of you in this audience, when I'm elected mayor, even if I didn't get a vote out of this room, you would get from me 100% absolute head-to-toe, hip-to-hip dedication to your problems, because that's what it's all about. Thank you very much. You're good for my spirit.
Well, that's what you need.
Thank you.
Just keep right on.
Thank you.
Here's you got just as much
This is just like the king giving
give
you.
Give me one.
I'm going to put it on you. Right. What's your name?
Georgia Alveen, and I live on the
Georgia
East
Alveen, I hereby dedicate you as a warrior for Washington in the front of the battle. May you conduct yourself
you
when Bernard would say, there's my brother, Judge Epton, and I'm proud of my brother. And now I say, I'm proud of my brother Bernard, who will be your next mayor. I'm so proud. On a very serious note, on the way here, he got a call that a number of the folks from out of the country were coming in to interview him. And under those circumstances, he paid his real estate taxes. And so I'm pinch hitting for him.
Two finish mill from public steel, and the two mills been down since the pipe industry fell underground, which has been almost a year now. My people's benefits are starting to run out. You know, they're really having a hard time losing their homes, paying their bills. But I think one thing good that came out of this whole layoff and bad times is that in bad times, people stick together. They really do. The best comes out in them. And that's what's happening right now with all of us and the committee and people just walking in out of the street saying, here, I'm giving you $50, help the people. You know, I'm working, help the laid off people. And I think it's beautiful.
They're playing a game with us, with our lives, and they're gonna keep on playing the same game until they reach their goal as far as concessions. And I'm totally against concessions because we came a long way since 1937. Whatever gain we have today, we made in the past, we made through struggling, and I don't see why anybody today should give up benefits.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, all I can say, I'm here this evening trying to work on some projects with John and the officers of this union involving the food program that you're trying to have here. And as my office as state senator, I am calling on all the people that I know that it'd be possible to raise any kind of food or donations they can for Local 1033. And we're also working with Alderman Podoliak on this also. So all I can say is Glenn Dawson is going to do his part for the steel workers of 1033 in the South Chicago area. And thank you very much for having me here this evening. Thank you.
Right now, we are trying to work something with him and Ed Podoliak, where our membership, the people that we have signed up, will receive turkeys instead of chickens for Christmas, because a turkey will go a lot longer than a chicken, all right?
I'm George Cervantes. I've been laid off now 11 months, and I'm hoping to come back soon if whenever things pick up fine, you know.
My name is Charles Searcy. I'm a crane man. Been laid off since April. Be glad to get back to work, I tell you that.
Gregory Turner, 9334 Clyde. Been laid off since April. We'd like to get back to work.
My name's Dave Martinez. Worked for Republic Steel. Laid off since May 5th.
Nobody expected a layoff so fast and yet so severe, you know, that it affect not only the union members, but I guess your, how would I say that? Your employees, your management. also affected them, you know, so it's very bad. It's bad over here in the south side of Chicago. Well, you know about Wisconsin Steel and U.S. Steel Southworks, so, you know, that's, let's hope that Republic Steel won't go in that same direction. We're hoping this is what the drive is all for, you know. I hope, you know, things work out and everybody has a Merry Christmas. That's the main thing.
Well, a lot of them are receiving unemployment compensation. For a lot of them, it ran out. A lot of them are on public aid. A lot of them got sent their wives out to work. And a lot of them, they ain't got nothing coming in. You know, it's kind of sad to sit here and have people come around and ask for a job, if I can get them a job, and grown men pretty near crying because they can't find the door because of, you know, their bills and rent, and the kids are catching hell, you know, because the guy ain't making no dough. It's some of the guys are really up against it out there.
All I could say is that I wish everybody in this room was back to work yesterday. Being a new politician and going out to different areas, we did the same thing around Thanksgiving time at the other steel mills, steel union halls. And believe me, starting January 12th, I've already asked to be put on a labor commission. I've already been asked to be put on a labor law commission. Anything that I can do to put all of everybody in this area, I am originally still Eastside Hedgers person. We've got to get everybody back to work. It's got to turn around. We don't want to have dinners and parties like this for the unemployed. We'd rather have a party where we're all employed, where we can all have a great time and not worry about the money that's got to be on the table tomorrow and the food. God bless everybody here. I hope you have a happy holiday. I made a small donation, it's not much, but I hope it goes a long way, and anything I can do through my business or political, I'll be here whenever you want me. Thank you, have a nice holiday.
Well, Castro has been a local man all his life, and he's works for the people also. And he's the one that we're really interested to get in. Also, Washington, we have to go along with the party, whatever, the Democratic Party.
Is the most historic in Chicago's history. And perhaps one of the most in our country, because it deals with two words, fair play. That's what trade unionism is all about. That's what this campaign is all about.
Once hair,
Repeat after me. I, Harold Washington, solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
I, Harold Washington, solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Illinois.
And the Constitution of the State of Illinois.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties of the office of Mayor of the City of Chicago.
That I will faithfully discharge the duties of the office of Mayor of the City of Chicago.
According to the best of my ability.
According to the best of my ability.
Congratulations.
Monday, I will issue an order to freeze all city hiring and raises. In order to reduce the city expenses by millions of dollars, we will have no choice but to release several hundred new city employees.
The future of this neighborhood is the same as the future of this country. We need a stimulus to the economy. We need a change in direction as far as where people can be employed. The steel industry, as we've known it, is gone. And this isn't a mining town where everything has been abandoned. That has happened.
How beautiful, how beautiful.
Thank you.